an art centre in the Old Town Hall and the land behind it, with artists and makers, retail and studio units. The Hoylake Christmas Lights Group, which Julian and a great team of volunteers have done an amazing job with this year. And the Hoylake Vision Community Planning Forum, which produced a neighbourhood development plan in consultation with the local community, an NDP, which was passed at local referendum just over a year ago. Now, the NDP is now part of the council's local plan, and we can answer questions about how that might impact on the council's proposals later on. And we've also produced this alternative eco-golf resort wildlife, wildfowl and wetland centre project, which we're about to explain in more detail today. If you haven't picked up a copy of this, please do. There's a load of them at the back. We brought 150. That may not be enough. It looks like it's not enough. But we do have more. Now, I just want to mention who we've consulted with over the course of this project over the last 6 years. Gareth Bradbury is the senior consultant of Wildfowl and Wetland Trust Consulting Limited. Nigel Sines is the business advice unit leader of RSPB. Sam Thomas is the programme director of the Gulf Environment Organisation. David McClay Kidd is the architect of the Macrihanish Dunes Golf Resort, which is an eco-golf resort. Dr. Keith Duff, who is now retired but was for 35 years the executive director and chief scientist of English Nature, or Natural England. And Peter Wilson, who is a chartered forester and chartered environmentalist. All of these people believe our proposals to be credible and achievable. We've done our homework. So the origins of the project. When HVL formed in 2009 to explore ways of tackling the issue of empty shops, Hoylake had a 25% vacancy rate. The council's idea of a five-star golf resort was at a very embryonic stage. But alarm bells were already ringing for us because of a question around funding. We suspected that some kind of development, whether residential, leisure or retail or commercial, would need to be in the minds of the council. So in 2011, we produced this document. Some of you may have seen an earlier iteration of this. We've now updated and printed a couple of hundred copies. Please do take one. Now, over the years, we've showed it to lots of people, including our ward councillors, and I'm sorry to say, until very recently, it was met with, at best, ambivalence, perhaps fueled by a significant degree of incredulity that the council's five-star project would go ahead. Well, 6 years on, here we are. Here we find ourselves, and in our view, this document is more relevant than ever, but still with very little political support or formal council recognition. Now, we hope this presentation will change that. So, in essence, this booklet suggests that the council need to consider integrating a commercially operated wildfowl and wetland centre on the site, capitalising on the growing trends for ecotourism and making the most of our existing natural assets and Natura 2000 protections, the SSSI, the Ramsar, SAC and PSBA status, for example. Now, we think this type of diversification will create a significantly more, less risky and longer term and much more sustainable underlying business model for the project than relying on the upfront revenue from residential development. Let's think about future generations. Note the gratuitous use of cute ducklings. Wildfowl and wetland centres are economically and environmentally sustainable. They bring in huge footfall, creating rewarding local employment and providing many wonderful education and leisure opportunities. Now, we've spoken to various organisations, as I said, including Wirral Wildlife, the Wildfowl and Wetland Trust, the RSPB and the Gulf Environment Organisation. And we found universal consensus that if designed and managed well, golf courses do benefit the environment and are havens for wildlife. But there's a big difference between water features that may attract some wildlife and make the game a bit more exciting for players, and improving an entire wetland and coastal ecosystem. Now, one of our advisors has been David McClay Kidd, this guy. He's the architect of the Macrihanish Dunes Resort in Kintyre, cited as one of the world's most eco-friendly coastal resorts in the world. So check out YouTube for the Macrihanish Dunes Golf Club to see how he approached that project. Now, at the same time, we've also expressed concerns about the council's beach management plan and did some research into it. And we uncovered some real concerns and a lot of misinformation going around. So you may be thinking, oh, why is he talking about the beach? Well, because many of the same birds live and feed on the shore as well as inland. The area of the proposed golf resort includes roosting sites for the black-tailed godwit, for example. is all part of a complex ecosystem and in need of tender, loving care, not two completely separate environments. You see, it makes no sense to us to even consider a wildfowl and wetland centre over there, while on Hoylake Beach here, where the birds also use, the only long-term plan in evidence seems to be to spray glyphosate ad infinitum in the complete absence of any qualitative or quantitative data about the natural coastal processes that are taking place. Now, in case you didn't already know, we should point out that the EU's classification of glyphosate states dangerous for the environment, toxic to aquatic organisms, may cause long-term adverse effects in the aquatic environment, and chronic long-term aquatic hazard. Manufacturers Monsanto, perhaps unsurprisingly, say the exact opposite. Now, a meeting about beach management at St. Luke's Church in 2013 clearly demonstrated a polarised view on the issues. It seems that many people are content with doing whatever it takes, including spraying chemicals, to remove the grass, while a similar number seems to be very much against it. Now, the conclusion of Natural England is that scraping, digging and rotaburying techniques serve only to spread the grass rather than to remove it. So they've approved further spraying using glyphosate. Okay? But in our view, and one that seems to be shared by a growing number of people, the current approach to beach management is ultimately doomed to failure, a futile effort to pause or reverse inevitable natural coastal processes. But the use of glyphosate is not the only option. We need to be thinking differently, and this proposed resort may help us do that. Now, what was particularly interesting from that meeting was an offer of both Liverpool universities to explore the idea of conducting reversible field trials, as recommended in this report by almost 20 years ago by Alan Jemmett of the Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service, a report which came to the same conclusion back then. So perhaps those studies could be funded by the Dong Energy Coastal Communities Fund over the long term. Because there's another issue which is not going to go away in a hurry: increasing flood risk as sea levels rise and global warming impacts on so many aspects of our lives. It's widely accepted that dunes, slacks and wetland systems are a highly efficient coastal flood defence, much cheaper and more efficient than hard defences. So again, because the proposed resort is in a flood risk, we can't talk about landscaping for a golf resort or even a wetland centre without thinking through the issues of flood defences, rather than increasing the flood risk to residents, businesses and infrastructure. So that also means thinking about the beach. Now, if you look online, you'll find a very informative video about the Environment Agency's fantastic work with the Wildfowl and Wetland Trust on this very issue at Steert Marshes. You see, whether we like it or not, the land behind being considered for the proposed golf resort and the beach are inextricably linked. Anything to do with the environment and with nature must be viewed holistically. At the moment, there's a worrying disconnect in this regard in the council's approach to the golf resort and the beach. And I think we need to join the dots while gaining a better understanding of the issues. Wildfowl and Wetland Trust would surely be the right partners for this. Now, we don't actually have a problem, HVL don't actually have a problem, with there being a golf resort in principle. Whilst it's true that golf club membership has been in decline, golf tourism is showing signs of growth. As a community interest company that supports economic development, we see this as an opportunity, but not at any cost. We're thinking holistically. The beacon scheme that I talked about earlier would be a great way to ensure visitors from leave a hotel and venture into Hoylake. We just can't bring ourselves to support the golf resort project if it's to be funded by the building of 150 luxury houses, whether on greenbelt or not, perhaps. We can't support it if it's to be one where the only water features are there to look pretty and to make the game a little more tricky. We can't support it when there appears to have been no real consideration or consultation on how the wildlife there and on the beach will be impacted by its design and long-term maintenance. And we certainly don't support a course which will have a heavy reliance on chemicals. As we've found, it's quite possible to build a golf course that uses the absolute bare minimum and even in part bans chemicals, unlike on our beach at the moment. We suggest that a high-level conversation should be taking place between the Council, the Wildfowl and Wetland Trust, the RSPB, the Golf Environment Organisation, the Environment Agency, Liverpool Universities, Dong Energy, Community Benefit Fund and others. We've spoken to them. the project could deliver a world-class eco-golf resort, integrated with a wildfowl and wetland centre that provides much greater opportunities for employment, leisure and education, whilst enhancing and protecting wildlife and taking a long-term holistic view towards improving flood defences and reducing flood risk. We've introduced the council to Wildfowl and Wetland Trust twice now, but sadly, you haven't taken up the offer. They've been in touch, but no conversation's taking place. I just want to read the most recent correspondence received from the Wildfowl and Wetland Trust consulting senior consultant director Gareth Bradbury. He says this: your proposal certainly lays out a plan true to the ethos of sustainable development. It ensures through a diverse offer that the landscape is changed only positively. Biodiversity is protected and, where possible, enhanced, and economic benefits come from a network of strong, ethically sound ventures fully integrated with the local community. We continue to look forward to helping in all or any stages of such a project, from data collection, feasibility studies, particularly for a visitor centre and wetland habitat enhancements, stakeholder engagement events, concept and detailed designs, including sustainable drainage schemes, wetland treatment systems, working with an architect for building design if necessary, drawing up specifications for contractors, site supervision during construction, and writing management. That's visitor centre and habitat plans. I heard nothing back from the council after you again put me in touch with them. So it might be pending the outcome of the meeting on the 9th of December that we arrange a teleconference with key staff to see what they may require from us. Shame. It is definitely worth including the Environment Agency and Natural England as stakeholders so all these things can be considered in one plan. So I hope this presentation and this document will give you food for thought. And I also hope that the Stop the Hoylet Golf Resort Group, along with others, as well as those who support the current golf resort plans, will get behind this proposal and encourage the council to rethink and dramatically reshape their plans in the light of this. We also hope that Margaret Greenwood and our ward councillors will get behind these proposals. And before I wrap this up, please consider one thing. If this eco-golf resort idea does go ahead, if we manage to make this happen, even if it eventually fails, the Wildfowl and Wetland Centre in which it will sit, which won't fail, will lend much greater protection against further development. There's nothing to lose by supporting this. It can and should be better.